This conference will now be recorded.
Okay. Bakkanal is composed of what's Bakkanal firstly? Bakkanal is a passage through which baby is born. So Bakkanal is composed of soft tissues and bones. Injuries might occur during the delivery to the soft tissue or to the bony structures. Coming to injuries to bony structures. Firstly, injury to symphysis pubis occurs. It occurs spontaneously due to strong uterine contractions. Not during the delivery of the baby. It might occur because of strong uterine contractions also, and it also occurs during forcible extraction of head to the pelvic rim by forceps or breech delivery. So nowadays we are not doing mid forceps and also breech delivery. We are doing assisted breech delivery, not complete breech extraction. I think you know the difference. Can anybody tell the difference between complete breech extraction and assisted breech delivery? Anybody? Okay, assisted breech delivery means we will allow the delivery of the breech spontaneously till the nape of the neck, then we'll assist during the delivery of the head. Whereas complete breech extraction is we'll deliver entire breech delivery through assistance. So if advantages with assisted breech delivery is as we allow spontaneous delivery, there will be minimal injuries to the Bakkanal. And coming to forceps, we are not using high forceps or mid forceps nowadays. So there is no forceful extraction of head. We are only using low forceps, where the presenting part should reach to the station of +3. So there is no forceful extraction. We will always deliver head by assisted controlled head delivery will do. Predisposing factors are multiparity, macrosomia, menores like McRoberts. I think you know regarding McRoberts, it is the menover we use for shoulder dystocia. After delivery of the head, if the shoulder is struck below the pelvic rib, we'll do this McRoberts maneuver. In this, we'll abduct the hip and knee and suddenly adduct them so that cephaloid dislocation of the pelvis will be seen, and there will be this will be creating more space and delivery of the shoulder. In this maneuver, we'll suddenly adduct the legs over the abdomen. During this maneuver, there might be injury to pubic symphysis and inherent joint loosening. Characteristic symptoms of suprapubic pain, as we all know, it is a most hallmark symptom that the patient will be experiencing. Suprapubic pain and tenderness with the radiation to the back of the legs, difficulty in walking, occasionally bladder dysfunction is may also be there. This is due to injury to the nerve supply of the bladder by pubic symphysis dislocation. Coming to signs, the gap between the pubic bones, tenderness of pressure, pain felt more particularly on movement of the limbs. X-ray and ultrasound are used to confirm the diagnosis. Coming to treatment, treatment is simple. Just immobilize the joint. A firm binder around the pelvis may also be applied, and this gives a feeling of security and comfort to the patient. Mild analysis and walking devices might be advised. Coming to fractures and dislocation, these occurs during extraction of the fetus, and those where the suprapubic angle is narrow. If the suprapubic angle is narrow, pressure of the head will be exerted exited backwards, so there might be dislocation or fractures of coccyx. Palpation of the mobile and displaced coccyx diagnose the condition. While we're doing the PV, we can palpate the dislocated coccyx and we can confirm the diagnosis. Occasionally, a persistent neuralgia is present and is known as coccydynia. In some cases, during the dislocation of the coccyx, there might be injury to the surrounding nerves, and this will result in persistent neuralgia. Management is usually symptomatic. Mild analgesics can be given. It should be advised to avoid direct pressure of the coccygeal region. Coming to next injury to sacroiliac synchondromesis starts early in pregnancy due to effect of relaxin. We all know due to pregnancy hormones, all the bone structures and ligaments are relatively relaxed, and it allows the delivery of the baby. This hormone relaxin is responsible for this relaxation. The sacroiliac joint, which normally resists the forward flexion of the sacral alley, becomes lax, and this gives rise to pain. There is flaring up of iliac bones and the ligaments of the joints are torn. The patient is unable to use her limbs freely and complains of pain in the region of sacrum. Rest in the bed with proper support to the pelvis with strapping, and it relieves the pain. Coming to the injuries to soft tissues, firstly, injury to the vulva. This is very common during the delivery. The lacerations are generally slight and may not require any treatment. Sometimes it is required to suture the tears with catgut. If there are mild mucosal injuries or slight injuries, we generally do not suture them, because blood supply of the vulvar region is very good and it will heal on its own. But if the injuries are deep or there is bleeding, then we'll suture the tears with catgut. Lacerations of the vestibule leads to severe hemorrhage, whereas lacerations in the vestibule, that laceration means it is a deep cut, leads to severe hemorrhage because blood supply of the vestibule is very high. So generally minor injury also leads to severe hemorrhage, so we should suture the laceration. Coming to vulval hematoma, this is the complication we see after delivery. This is due to collection of blood in the vulval region. Vulval region is a loose connective tissue, so and with high vascularity. If there is any injury to the blood vessel, it will be collected in the vulval region, and it will be presenting as vulval hematoma. This can occur either after spontaneous delivery, or more commonly following instrumental vaginal delivery or improper sutured episiotomy. It can also be occurred in spontaneous delivery, and it is more common in instrumental delivery where we apply forceps or vacuum. It is more common with forceps than with a vacuum. And improper suturing of episiotomy. This is mainly in the, we'll suture episiotomy in three layers: mucosa, muscle, and skin. If we do not obliterate the dead space in the muscle layer, there will be space for collection of the blood. So we generally suture muscle in 2 to 3 layers if the episiotomy is too deep. So we should properly suture the muscle layer, otherwise there will be dead space, and this will give rise to vulval hematoma later on. And while suturing episiotomy, we should secure all the bleeds. If not, they will later on present as vulval hematoma. The bleeding is from the branches of pudendal arteries or paravaginal veins. This complication usually occurs after delivery and rarely in the second stage of labor. Vulval hematoma in second stage of labor, this is due to instrumental vaginal delivery. This is most common cause of vulval hematoma. Occurs due to excessive stretching of vulval tissues. this results in this risk is more when there is there are engorged veins in vulva or vulval varicosities. This vulval varicosities and engorged veins are generally we see in hypertensive patients. The blood extravasates into the soft loose areolar tissues of the labium, producing a large hematoma. We can see in this picture, this is hematoma. Vulval hematoma after delivery, most common cause is improperly sutured episiotomy or unattended perineal tears. Generally, we can skip suturing perineal tears if there is no bleeding. If there is a bleeding, even a small perineal tear should be sutured. Otherwise, they will land up in vulval hematomas. As we already discussed, improperly sutured episiotomy is also the most common cause of vulval hematoma. We should obliterate all the dead space in the muscle layer. Any hematoma which is sufficient to cause symptoms requires incision, drainage, and suturing. If we find a vulval hematoma, we should first incise the wound and we should search for any bleeding vessels. Then we should ligate the vessel and we should let out all the hematoma collected and then suture the site. Coming to clinical features of vulval hematoma, symptoms are increasing swelling on the one side of vulval region. Swelling is painful and tender. There might be nutritional difficulties and retention of the urine. These nutritional difficulties and retention of urine is mainly due to the pain in the vulval area. Coming to signs, the swelling appears bluish or purplish due to blood collected inside the vulval tissue. Depending on the bleeding, the patient might go into hemorrhagic shock, requiring blood transfusion and effective resuscitation. Vulval hematoma is a very serious thing to take because there might be excessive bleeding and the patient might land up in hemorrhagic shock and may also need blood transfusion. So we should always check the mother after suturing of episiotomy in at least within an hour so that we will avoid these complications. If we do not follow up the mother after episiotomy suturing, some may land up in vulval hematoma and the bleeding will be going on and they may land up in a hemorrhagic shock. Coming to treatment, the hematoma must be incised under general anesthesia and the clots are removed. Bleeding points should be located and if possible sutured to close the cavity. The bleeding points more often will not be identified, hence the bed of the hematoma is sutured by running matrix sutures to secure hemostasis. If needed, blood transfusion is given depending on the size of the hematoma and condition of the patient. Coming to perineal tears, these are most common injuries we will encounter in normal delivery. Perineum is most common location of injury. It can see rapid delivery of the head or shoulders. In normal delivery also, we will not allow rapid delivery of the head. We'll do controlled delivery of the head with the pelvic support, perineal support. So rigid perineum, as in elderly primary gravida. In elderly primary gravida, the skin and the tissues will not be stretchable. They are rigid and which leads to perineal tears. Cicatrization due to trauma. These scars are due to previous normal delivery where you will be suturing the episiotomy. Later on, they will be presented as scars in the later deliveries and they are not stretchable. And tears will be commonly occur around this scar. Operations are new growths. Other factors which are associated with the third or fourth degree perineal tears are birth weight over 4 cases. This is macrosomia. Large baby, persistent occipital posterior position. We all know in OP position, the engaging diameters and are relatively more greater than the normal diameters. So there might be injuries to the perineum, nulliparity, and induction of labor. In induction of labor, the perineum will not be ready, adjusted to the normal delivery. Whereas if the patient naturally lands up in the labor, the perineum will be prepared for the normal delivery, where we induce or in preterm delivery, the perineum will not be ready for the delivery of the baby. There will be more perineal days in epidural analgesia. Because in epidural analgesia, we will land up in applying forceps. Second stage, the second stage is longer than 1 hour. This is a delay in the second stage and shoulder dystocia. Degrees of perineal lacerations are, there are 4 degrees of perineal lacerations. These are very important for your practical and theory purpose. First degree is injury to the perineal skin only. This is very superficial and only skin is involved. Second degree is injury to perineum and perineal muscles. Third degree, can anyone say episiotomy comes under which degree of perineal lacerations? We generally give episiotomy for normal delivery, no? It will in which category it will get fitted? First degree, second degree, or third degree? Okay, the episiotomy we give is second degree perineal laceration. It will include injury to the perineum and perineal muscles. Coming to third degree, injury to the perineum involving the anal sphincter complex. Coming to 3A, if the less than 50% of the external anal sphincter is torn, that is 3A. If more than 50%, it comes under 3B. If the internal anal sphincter is also involved, it is 3C. Coming to fourth degree, injury to the perineum involving the anal sphincter complex and anal perineum, anal epithelium. So fourth degree means it is through and through in laceration joining the vagina and the rectum. It will involve all the layers in between, including anal perineum epithelium. You can see this here. This is first degree, second degree perineal tear. This is how we give episiotomy. It will include vaginal mucosa, perineal skin, and perineal muscles. Anal sphincter will be intact. We generally don't give midline episiotomy. We'll give a mediolateral episiotomies. This is how generally the perineal tears will occur. It will generally occur in the midline. Third degree, we can see that external anal sphincter is involved. This is fourth degree. We can see both the vagina and rectum is completely exposed and in between all layers are torn. What are the principles in management? First, we have to recognition of type of perineal tear, examination of perineal injury. Find out which layers it is involved. Vaginal and rectal examination to exclude association of anal sphincter injury. We can do rectal examination and we can see the gripping action of the sphincter. Immediate repair of the perineal injury is advisable when compared to delayed repair. Immediate repair will reduce the bleeding and pain, prevent edema and fibrosis. Process. It's a successful first repair offers the best cure rate. The labia, clitoris, and urethra should be examined for any tears. Coming to repair, in lacerations of first degree, to oppose the edges of the mucous membranes is suited with catheter. Skin with the entire thickness of the perineal body may be sutured off. Laceration of the second and third degrees, repair the external anal sphincter muscles. Either by PDS or polygalactin. In this third degree perineal tears, we should first suture. Generally, we will follow the order like mucosa, muscle, and skin. But in third and fourth third degree perineal tears, we should first suture external anal sphincter and then go for mucosa, then perineal muscles, and then skin. Repair of internal sphincter muscles. Either by fine sutures, size such as 3 PDS or 20 Vicodil. For proper urine, the aftercare of the patient is important. We should give broad spectrum antibiotics for 5 to 7 days. The parts should be kept clean and dry. Physiotherapy and pelvic floor exercises should be advised to retain the sphincter activity. Follow-up and management in subsequent pregnancies. Assess 6 to 12 weeks postpartum with anorectal physiology test and anal ultrasound. Asymptomatic women, defects of greater than one quadrant, cesarean section is advised. No clinical evidence of deficient perineum, vaginal delivery can be allowed. Symptomatic women with severe injuries, secondary sphincter repair and subsequent pregnancy should be delivered by cesarean section. Coming to lacerations of vagina, generally occurs in post pelvis and breech extraction. Frequent when head has to be rotated artificially. This is a high forceps or mid forceps where we will rotate the head and deliver the head. It is relatively less common in outlet forceps. Severe if the forceps slips on traction. More severe form when the head has been jammed in the pelvis for a long time. When the tear involves the fornices, it may extend to pelvic cellular space. We should suture all these under anesthesia. The chief danger of vaginal tears is infection. Slight lacerations of vagina, if there is minor laceration, we can leave if not bleeding, we can leave it. It will heal on its own due to good blood supply. If there is extensive tear, it is necessary to be sutured. Coming to laceration of the cervix. Cervix, as we all know, it is not easily reachable thing. So the chief causes of cervical laceration are rapid delivery of the fetus by natural power or assisted labor when the cervix is not completely dilated. This is very important. Should check for a complete dilatation of cervix before going for assisted deliveries. Should not apply forceps if the cervix is not completely dilated, and it injuries might also occur in precipitated labors because there is a sudden delivery of the head and the baby. It might lead to cervical lacerations. While applying forceps when the cervix is not fully dilated, extraction of the breech through an inadequately dilated cervix. Scarring of the cervix results from previous injuries to the cervix, like amputation of the cervix or conization. Circular turn or eversion of the cervix due to faulty application of the vacuum cuff. If the cervix, we should not apply forceps if the cervix is not fully dilated, but we can apply vacuum even though cervix is not fully dilated. But we should see that cuff of the vacuum should not include cervix, otherwise there will be eversion of the cervix, circular tear. Cervix is caught between the cup and the head of the baby. When traction is applied, a whole ring of cervical tissue comes out. Cervical tears are generally discovered after delivery as they cause hemorrhage, which may be prognosis. Coming to prognosis, small tears of cervix usually heal. Larger tears may immediately give rise to severe hemorrhage and later produce extensive scarring, which tends to and involves the vaginal wall. This leads to ectropion or persistent vaginitis. In some cases, sterility, repeated abortions, premature labor or dystocia may occur as late sequel of oral lacerations. We should first of all identify the laceration and we should suture the laceration if there is bleeding. If we do not identify the laceration, there will be later sequelae like repeated abortions of preterm labor. Coming to management, minor tears with no severe hemorrhage, no special treatment is required. We can leave them. Tears which give rise to significant hemorrhage should be sutured. Since the cervix is flabby after delivery, a distal examination does not diagnose cervical tears. We cannot diagnose a cervical tear with the distal examination. by simple digital examination as the cervix is flabby. It is fully dilated to its maximum capacity. So we should examine the cervix with the help of expansion holding forceps. A broad sim speculum is inserted and anterior lip of the cervix is caught by sponge holding forceps. Keeping this in as an identification point, another sponge holding forceps is applied to the lateral side and examined. Now keeping the lateral sponge holding forceps in situ, and the first forceps is removed and applied to the lateral of the lateral wall of the cervix. This technique is for walking around the cervix and is very useful in identifying tears of the cervix. So at least we will be needing two sponge holding forceps. We will remove the first forceps and apply later to the second forceps, and again we will remove the second forceps and apply later side of the first forceps. Likewise, we'll walk around the cervix completely 360 degrees and we'll examine for the tears. Coming to the rupture of uterus, this is the most serious complication that may occur during pregnancy or in labor. Complete rupture, there are two types, like complete rupture and incomplete rupture. All the three cords of the uterus, including the peritoneum, it is complete uterine rupture, uterus rupture. Incomplete when the peritoneal covering is intact. The picture showing tear of anterior uterine wall. Coming to causes, previous surgeries on the uterus like cesarean section, myomectomy, metroplasty, deep corneal resection of the fallopian tube, obstructed labor, external cephalic version. We generally do this external cephalic version for breech. In this procedure, if we forcefully do the version, there might lead to uterus rupture. Operative vaginal delivery, difficult forceps delivery, breech extraction and destructive operations. Nowadays we are not at all doing destructive operations, and we are also not doing breech extraction for term baby or baby with more weight, birth weight more than 4 kg. Trauma by curette, sound and so on. The use of oxytocin, high parity, pregnancy in the undeveloped uterine form. Coming to clinical features, unexplained sudden maternal tachycardia, abdominal pain, vaginal bleeding. These are the clinical features which suggests of uterine rupture, and we should be very, very alert to see these features to diagnose this early. Sudden persistent fetal heart rate abnormality. Mostly the fetal heart rate abnormality is fetal bradycardia. Easy palpation of fetal parts through the abdominal wall. And the contracted uterus is felt separately, lying to the one side. The presenting part recedes. Shifting dullness. Signs of hypovolemic shock. Shoulder tip pain due to hemoperitoneum irritating the diaphragm. Irritation of the diaphragm causes frequent pain to the shoulder and hematuria. Coming to management, we should go for immediate laparotomy with simultaneous treatment of shock and hemorrhage by rapid and sufficient blood transfusion. Before shifting to the OP, ensure two large bore cannula, at least a size of 18 or less, with the normal saline and ringer lactate and compatible blood on flow, 8 to 10 liters per minute of oxygen by mass, continuous bladder dryness, continuous monitoring of pulse, BP and respiration, adequate amount of blood and components should be ordered and kept ready, written consent for hysterectomy. We should take consent for hysterectomy beforehand, as we are suspecting a uterine rupture or we have confirmed diagnosis of uterine rupture. After laparotomy, the fetus and placenta, which are often lying pre-peritoneal cavity, are removed. Broad-spectrum antibiotic therapy to control post-operative peritonitis is essential. The choice at laparotomy or hysterectomy and conservative surgery. We can repay the interest, or most of the cases we cannot repay the interest. So we generally land up in hysterectomy. So we should take the consent for hysterectomy beforehand. Coming to hysterectomy, total hysterectomy is best procedure. It is indicated if the uterus is damaged beyond repair. Generally, we should try for repairing the uterus. If we generally go for hysterectomy if the uterus is damaged beyond repair. Conservative surgery is like a control of hemorrhage and repair of the uterus is done if the patient condition is stable and she decides to retain her uterus. The patient is primary gravidia. She generally decides to retain the uterus for later pregnancies. And most of the cases, if there is uterine rupture, there baby will be stillbirth or IUD. Most of the cases, so the woman will be decide to retain the uterus for later pregnancies. If we can preserve the uterus, we can try. But most of the cases, the uterus will be damaged beyond repair. Prophylaxis is early diagnosis and proper management of CPD. You should diagnose the CPD in beforehand, and we should plan for an elective cesarean section. And we should diagnose small presentations and other factors giving rise to obstruction will prevent rupture of uterus. Coming to prophylaxis, early diagnosis and proper management of CPD, small presentations and other factors giving rise to obstruction will prevent rupture of uterus. Thank you. Are there any doubts in this topic? Any doubts? Am I audible? Someone respond.
Yes, ma'am.
Are there any doubts? Hello?
No, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
No doubts.